Hey, good morning, one and all. It is the 17th of October, 2018. It's Elizabeth Cronice McLaughlin. You all know why you're here. It's Resistance Live. Thanks for being here. Quick shout out to our fabulous team, including all sorts of people, the fabulous Megan Baker, and all sorts of other folks who are behind the scenes, doing all the good work of keeping this broadcast troll and bot free. And if you care to support us and our team, we would very much appreciate your contributions on Patreon, patreon.com/resistancelive. So I came with no notes today. There are a couple of things that I just want to mention really quickly here that I think are sort of significant to where we find ourselves right now. So, like, literally the president, I have MSNBC on back there. I have to start turning the TV off because it's just like ruining my health. But the president is literally talking about the Saudis buying $450 billion of military gear. While basically saying that, like Pompeo's on his way back from Turkey and Saudi Arabia and like, they've asked for this investigation, blah, 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 blah. Meanwhile, like 5 minutes ago, the New York Times broke additional details on Khashoggi's murder. And the details continue to be incredibly grisly. I'm like almost loathe to discuss them in the event that some of you might have little kids with you while you're watching today because they're really bad. I mean, he was conscious for the beginning of the dismemberment. And the details that continue to come out about this are horrifying, just horrifying. So, we're now in a position where the president of the United States is justifying the torture and murder of a journalist because we make money off the Saudis, and he makes money off the Saudis. And notwithstanding his denial that he doesn't get any money from the Saudis, the most recent report about how Trump Hotels was functioning shows that the Saudis are dumping enormous amounts of money into the Trump hotels and have also in the past bought like somewhere in the range of $40 to $50 million in Trump apartments. So there's a lot there, to discuss. I personally am very concerned at what this would mean from a turning point standpoint if we do not see some kind of retaliatory effort as a result of this. And I've said as much on Twitter in the last couple of days that, my biggest concern here is that if the murder of a permanent resident journalist goes unredressed, the next place it will happen is here. And so, I'm very much focused on that particular issue at the moment, in addition to everything that's happening for the midterm. So the one thing I will say is that a number of you asked me to comment on what's happening in Georgia and early voter turnout. So there's a couple of things happening in Georgia that I want to point out. Apparently, there is three times already, three times the voter turnout in early voting in Georgia than what we have ever seen before. That bodes very well for the Democrats, by the way. As you all may know, I trust that you know that the reality of where we find ourselves is that when turnout is higher, Democrats win. So that's really good. And indeed, I saw some photographs just from very early this morning that there are voting lines around the block right now in Cobb County, which is fantastic. So, again, we'll see what happens with this, but my expectation at the moment is that things are turning out pretty well in Georgia. That said, there have been, in addition to everything that Brian Kemp did with regard to the voting rolls, which we've already talked about, and there have been some stays of that are going to allow the people who were supposed to be scrubbed to vote. There have been some very prominent incidents, including with our friends at Black Voters Matter, where a busload of African American seniors who were loaded up and headed to the polls for early voting were stopped, reportedly because the bus didn't have the right permits to take them to the polls. So this is already a major issue. It's been covered dramatically. Maddow has it up on Twitter right now. Joy Reid has been covering it. And really, I know there's a lot of discussion at the moment about like what can we do about this. Well, I have to tell you that one of the things you can do about it that's very significant is amplify it. Meaning, retweet what I'm tweeting about it on Twitter. Retweet what's being posted by other news sources about it. It's incredibly important that we draw attention to voter suppression efforts because the more widely known it is, the more outrage there is about it, the more likely it is that those processes will stop. Voter suppression efforts survive in silence. And one of the things that's particularly dangerous about voter suppression in small numbers, which fundamentally we're talking about 40 seniors here with the Black Voters Matters bus, is that if those efforts are allowed to continue unabated all over the state or all over the South or all over places where there are enormous voting populations of black people, in the aggregate, it really seriously adversely impacts elections, not to mention the fact that it's a violation of civil rights. So it is incredibly important that you yourself are sharing the stories of what is happening here. The situation in North Dakota is very similar. And again, Maddow has done a good job of covering this, but as well as, you know, the situation in Texas with that historically black university where actually voting rights were restored as a result of Maddow's reporting. But, you know, the fundamental reality of where we find ourselves is that if people are not watching Rachel Maddow right now on this, they're probably not aware of how much is going on nationwide right now to suppress the votes of people of color and indigenous populations. And it's a lot. So even though the initial voter turnout in Georgia looks very good for us, it is still incredibly important that we are talking about voter suppression efforts, because where we are right now is that the Republicans fundamentally, from at least what we're seeing in many of the major polls, are in for a big blue wave unless they cheat. And so part of what is happening here is that, you know, we need to draw attention to this. I want to mention one other thing here that came to my attention yesterday, which is this. Please make sure if you are voting by mail that you are checking the amount of postage that is required on your ballot. Because here in California, for instance, it's a first class mailing. So that means you have to have a 50-cent stamp. Your old school 49-cent stamps will not get your ballot sent to the right place. So it's incredibly important that you check the postage if you are voting by mail. And indeed, we have heard some stories about ballots being rejected for exactly that reason. I personally, I know that there are some reports of voter suppression efforts related to mail-in ballots in red states. That most of that at this moment in time is anecdotal. Nonetheless, if you are concerned about it, you do have an opportunity, even if you got a ballot by mail, to walk that ballot into your polling place on election day. And if you are concerned about it, I recommend that you do that. I am not personally concerned about it here in California, because we have not heard reports of that in California, and that's the reason why I voted by mail yesterday. So I do think it's important that we pay attention to those issues. And if you're worried about it, just walk it into your polling place on election day itself. Beto O'Rourke did debate Ted Cruz last night. I did not watch the entire thing. I will tell you, I continue to be very impressed by Beto. And I will just add that when I was on my speaking tour last year, met many of you around the country when I was doing that for Resistance Live, we did go to Dallas. And the person who hosted me in Dallas is my dear old friend, Susan Canape, who more than a year ago was working on behalf of Beto's campaign and last night posted that she was watching the debate in her Beto shoes, because she actually had a pair of shoes that like have Beto's name on them, like right up front and center, which was super fun. You know, obviously I'm very impressed by everything that he's saying. And I do think there's something to be said about the interesting combination there of fighting back with the inspirational and justice-oriented commitment that he continues to make. You know, we are seeing some of that in other potential 2020 candidates. I'll just add that. I do think Beto is one to keep an eye on. Who knows if he's going to run for president in 2020 if he just gets elected to the Senate this year. But I will tell you that that man has a very bright future ahead of him. I don't think anybody who's watched the debate or watched him in action can deny it. And I personally have also just, this needs a big shout out, have been very impressed with what he's had to say about racial justice and racial equity, including in his conversations in black churches about issues related to police brutality and violence. So, you know, I am keeping my eye on Beto O'Rourke, as we all should be, I think. And you know, there was a poll that came out this morning that said he's trailing Ted Cruz. I'll believe that when I see it. I mean, you don't get 55,000 people turning out for a political rally, let alone when you're somebody who's visited every county in Texas, some of them twice, without, you know, there being a big wave of support and enthusiasm behind your campaign. And we all know that the polls are not necessarily always accurate. So so we'll see what's happening there. Okay, last point for today that I want to make. There is a new initiative that I shared on Twitter this morning, which is called Gimme Five. That is an effort where, you know, you are like, if you are not able to get out in Canvas, there are five particular actions that you can opt into to help to support the 2018 election. It includes things like mailing five postcards, making five phone calls, text banking five people. So please go check that out if you're looking for an initiative that allows you to do something quick and easy from home that still supports the efforts of pushing toward the 2018 elections, which, as you all know from all the broadcasts this week, is really where my focus is right now. I think that's it for today. And, you know, the only thing that I will add here, oh, there is one other thing I just wanted to mention, which is really important, relates to Robert Mueller's investigation. So Bloomberg did a piece this morning with a very misleading headline that said Robert Mueller was about to drop a report after the midterms that was going to wind all of this up. And there have been some other rumors that have come out in the last couple of days that Mueller's under pressure from Rod Rosenstein to wind down the investigation after the midterms. This is my two cents on that. Please remember that it was a year ago, like, that the White House was saying that the Robert Mueller investigation was going to be wound down by Thanksgiving. So I will not buy any of this until I see it. And please remember that Robert Mueller's charge is to investigate until the investigation is done. There is no artificial timetable on that. And Seth Abramson wrote a really good thread about this on Twitter this morning. I reposted it and said that I concur that anybody who's been following this in any depth, and who also, by the way, understands the way the law works, knows that it basically at this point, y'all know I'm very loath. I'm going to do my little speculation flash right above my head right now. But y'all know I'm loath to speculate. But I'm going to say this. I think it is incredibly unlikely that this investigation will wind down without an indictment of Jared Kushner, Don Jr., and Roger Stone at bare minimum. And, you know, we still have this issue hanging out there of whether or not a sitting president can be indicted. If we happen to flip the House and potentially at least take a majority in the Senate, impeachment becomes a much more real possibility here. So, you know, I am not putting my weight behind that Bloomberg article until we get through the midterms. And I will also say that, you know, anybody who has been face to face with Robert Mueller has blinked. So, you know, Paul Manafort lost a motion yesterday to wear a suit to court the next time he appears in the Eastern District of Virginia. And he's cooperating now. And we had news, as you all know, earlier this week that Michael Cohen has sat down for 50 hours of interviews with Robert Mueller so far. So there's and I feel like I've been saying this for 2 years, but there's, you know, maybe not 2 years because he only started in May of 2017. But, you know, for more than a year now, for 15 months at least, that, you know, Robert Mueller's investigation is tight. It is on lockdown. They are not leaking things to the press. They know a hell of a lot more than we do. And, you know, the iceberg that's underneath the water on this one, the size of that thing is anybody's guess. So so I am of the opinion that we're going to get through the midterms and there's going to be a lot that drops on this very quickly. It has been remarkably quiet inside Robert Mueller's investigation from what we've seen from the public display in the last little while. But that, again, is not a surprise because of some of the optional, again, I want to reiterate, optional regulations of the Department of Justice about the potential impact to elections. All that said, you know, Robert Mueller is not even close to done from what we have seen so far. And so, you know, again, you know, I said this yesterday. I did my big pep talk yesterday. I'm going to say it again. The light at the end of the tunnel right now is the midterms. That's the only thing we should be focused on. And I just really want to encourage every one of you to do something, whatever it is. Because once we get past the midterms, especially if we take both the House and the Senate, things change dramatically in this country in the context of what's going to happen next. There will be accountability. There will be subpoenas coming out of the committees. All the committees flip in terms of chairmanships and responsibilities as soon as the House and the Senate are put into office in January. So things will change dramatically in this country if we can do the right thing in this election. All right. So that's it for today. Lots of love to all of you. I hope you're all hanging tight and doing well. Keep up the good fight. Make your efforts. My phone has rung 6 times this morning already with people who are phone banking. So, you know, just know that I'm on the receiving end as well as the pushing forward end of this. And I will talk to all of you tomorrow. All right. Thanks so much, everybody. And if you like what you see here, please support our staff on Patreon. They're doing like so much behind the scenes answering questions for all of you, including on things like, you know, who are you voting for and where can I find information and I need help here and I want to phone bank here and how do I do this. So we would love your contributions. Patreon.com/resistancelive. Thanks so much. Bye.